Welcome to Politicking. I'm Larry King. Joining me from Clute, Texas, is one of my all-time favorite guests, former Congressman Ron Paul, who made White House bids twice as a Republican, once in 1988 as a Libertarian Party candidate. And he's the founder of the Ron Paul Institute for Peace and Prosperity and the Ron Paul Channel online. That's a great show, by the way. He joins us from Clute, Texas. Ron is a physician. What are your thoughts on the story everyone's talking about, the Ebola outbreak?
Well, right now I'm concerned about the hysterical reaction that we're getting. I think it's very, very serious and obviously of a concern for everybody. But I was saying the other day that if we have another breakout and have another case and have the second case of Ebola that originated here in the United States, the headline will say, Ebola has increased by 100%. In other words, I think it's very important, but I think it's way overblown. I think in comparison to other things, I think there are some other medical things that we ought to worry about. I mean, tuberculosis is still a very serious illness. We have over 500 people die every year, but we're not talking about. We still have 15,000 people a year die from HIV, and that's pretty bad, and that's an epidemic. So right now, I think the concern is overblown. I hope I'm right on this, and I hope it is contained, but it certainly is in the news. There's no doubt about it.
Your son, the Senator Rand Paul, said, and others are accusing U.S. authorities of downplaying the Ebola situation. Your son criticized President Obama for sending troops to Liberia, the epicenter of the Ebola outbreak in West Africa. He says it's possible they could carry the disease back to the United States. Is your son overreacting?
Well, I don't think so, because I agree with him about sending troops over there. You know, it seems like we're such a militant country. We get ourselves into all kinds of troubles economically and on foreign policy, and always the answer is military, military, and drop some bombs and do this. And it just all of a sudden have a medical crisis in Liberia, and all of a sudden we send 3,000 troops, and they're supposed to solve this problem. I think that's really weird, and I don't think it means anything at all. I think, if anything, it could increase the chance of things being spread.
In recent comments, the Center for Disease Control and Prevention, the chairman of that, the head, Thomas Frieden, said, in the 30 years I've been working in public health, the only thing like this has been AIDS. You agree with that?
Well, to a degree, but I think that if he thinks it's as serious as AIDS, maybe someday we might look back and see it. But right now, I don't think it comes anywhere close. I mean, that's a pan epidemic. I mean, we're still losing 15,000 a year, and it's really controllable if people understand exactly how AIDS is spread, but it seems like we're not allowed a lecture on that. So, and before there were a lot more than 15,000. I mean, I think it's over 600,000 people died from AIDS, so I think it's way premature to compare Ebola with AIDS. But the danger is, if somebody's going to say, oh, well, you're downplaying the danger. No, I think all illnesses are dangerous. I think tuberculosis is very dangerous. I think any one of us is much more vulnerable in getting on an airplane with somebody with a cough and catching tuberculosis than we are catching Ebola. And people don't put it in that same perspective.
So, Ron, if you were running a television network, you wouldn't be covering it as much as the networks are?
Yeah, I might cover it because it's in the news, but I might be trying to quiet people down and put it in a proper perspective and not have people panicking over it, because sometimes that causes things to go wrong, especially in medicine. Larry, I remember we had a sort of a panic type situation in 1976, right after I was first elected to Congress in a special election, and it had to do with the flu breaking out, and President Ford said we have to inoculate everybody. Two of us voted against it, another doctor and myself. It turned out a lot more people died from the flu shots than they did from the flu. The flu was a fluke. So that taught me a lesson. Be a little cautious, have a proper perspective, do what you have to do, but don't panic. Right now, I think the panic is much more dangerous and will cause more harm than the disease itself.
Have we made too many cuts in the public health system? Budget cuts dropped for the CDC from $6.5 billion to $5.9 billion. Senator Warren of Massachusetts said, we're spending now billions of dollars in emergency response instead of spending money in advance for more research for this kind of problem. You agree with her?
No, I don't, because I don't think sending the army and spending more money is the answer to this. You know, there's one firm over there in Liberia that has 80,000 workers, and they're very protective. They have had three cases. They do all the quarantining right now, and they have a special interest, a humanitarian interest. They have a financial interest, and they only have three cases out of the whole thing, and they've taken over completely and totally because they all live in one community. So I would say, you know, the market is still worthwhile thinking about. And if we look at the dependency on government, how dependent should we be on the government to provide safety and security, you know, from our foreign policy and keep us out of wars? How good are they at providing privacy for us? They can provide secrecy for government and no privacy for us. So I don't like to depend on a government that I have so little faith in.
But Senator Warren is saying we should be doing more in research than in after-the-fact spending.
Yeah, I think so, and that's why you should get out of the way and let the companies do it. But research, we always put a roadblock in it. Right now, there are experimental drugs, and believe it or not, they're not allowed to use them unless they get special permission from the food FDA. And why should you and I have to get special permission from the government to allow somebody to use an experimental drug? Also, the drugs have been delayed getting on the market. Who knows, without an FDA, we might have had a drug on the market, but it's very, very costly to go through the process. So I think in many ways the government obstructs and prevents these from happening. And I resent the fact that somebody who's dying from cancer or an infection has to go and get bureaucratic permission from the government to say, yeah, I want to take a risk. That should be between the doctor and the patient.
I've often admired you so much. During your long career, have you ever felt like Don Quixote, that you were swinging at windmills and they're not listening?
Well, I never quite thought of it that way, but I think I sort of assumed that nobody would listen, and for that reason, I was surprised when I got a few people to listen. All of a sudden, you know, in the last 8 years or so, you know, all of a sudden the campus young people have had an intense interest, and I thought, hey, I didn't expect this. I thought I should, if I believed in something, I should tell the people in my district what I believe in and vote that way and see if I could get reelected and set a standard. And maybe someday, you know, in 50 years from now, somebody will say, I wonder who that guy was. So I'm very surprised. I'm very surprised that a few people have looked more carefully a lot sooner.
All right, I'm very interested in your assessment of Obama and ISIS. How are we handling this? What do you make of this incredible problem?
Well, I think he's handling it very poorly because, you know, bombing seven Muslim countries doesn't win friends and influence people. You know, that tends to get people pretty angry at us. And I think there's always always the radicals within all the religions, and if you stir them up, they are going to strike back. So I believe the growth of ISIS is a reflection of a deeply flawed foreign policy. And the more, and then when we see this violence, all we can do is resort, sort of like the Fed, all we can do is print more money and spend more money. In foreign policy, it's send more troops and drop more bombs, and they don't realize that has something to do with the spread of the radicals, because the radicals aren't happy with the government we put in place in Iraq. What a stupid policy and a stupid war. There was no Al-Qaeda in Iraq. So we've been participating in these conditions. We have given fodder to those people who want to build the ranks. And the more we do, the bigger the ranks get. And so to me, it's not a shocking surprise to find out ISIS is doing well. And they could not have this success unless they're getting some support from the people in these villages. I mean, how can 20,000 people take over a country unless they're getting some support?
Right.
So I would say that a deeply flawed foreign policy contributes to our problems there.
Agreed. Let's say the war in Iraq was a terrible mistake. But now what do you do? What do you do now? Okay, that was a mistake. Now what?
Well, if it was a mistake to go in, in medicine, if you're making a mistake and giving the wrong medicine, the sooner you quit, the better. So I would say, yes, it was a mistake, and that mistake has continued, and we continue to do the same thing over and over again.
So what do you do?
I would say if we should, I'd come home as soon as possible, because, it's a very serious problem over there, and I think we just muddy the waters. I would do what Ronald Reagan did when the Marines got killed in Lebanon. He said he didn't realize how irrational the people of that region were, and that if we had followed a non-interventionist policy, the Marines would still be alive. But he says he didn't know it was so bad. If he had known it about the conditions of the politics of that region, he'd have never sent the Marines in. And he brought them home, and we never heard another story about it. And yet he had always said, I would never turn tail and run. And then he wrote that up in his memoirs. Very interesting stuff, because he made a mistake and he recognized it. We've made a mistake. It's not doing any good. Just throwing in more bombs and killing more people makes no sense whatsoever.
So we're not the world's protector. A recent Wall Street Journal NBC News poll, 72% of Americans believe that we'll wind up sending ground troops. What do you make of that?
Yeah, I'm afraid that's the case. Right now, the war propagandists are winning. A year ago, the people were strongly in our side of non-intervention and didn't want the president to go bomb. But if you look at the major networks, if you look at everything the government says, if you look at two political parties, who's really resisting it? It has to do with the way they have played this recent violence of ISIS, and this is emotional. But you don't get a fair shake, from the media, because the war propagandists are in charge. And believe me, there's a few people in the military-industrial complex that's not worrying all that much. You know, they blow up all these missiles, and they just go back to rebuilding them again. And here we're terrified about the taking over the world with a group of people that doesn't have a Navy or an Air Force or intercontinental ballistic missiles, and they're marching through because they're fighting for their homeland, and they've been able to radicalize the people. And so I think that's a reflection of our failed policy.
So ISIS, in your opinion, is no threat to the United States?
It's a threat because we keep aggravating them. When they were, the Mujahideen, when we were their buddies, they weren't a threat to us. But the more involved we got, it morphed into the Al-Qaeda. And then we took on Iraq when they weren't involved with 9/11. Now it's morphed into ISIS. Sure, they're very dangerous. And there would only be a couple hundred if we would just leave them alone. But we're giving them the incentive to get more members constantly. And this is not a good sign. And I think we're building a great deal of danger for ourselves. And I'm with Ronald Reagan. If you make a mistake, just come home.
We'll have more with the always outspoken, delightful guest, Ron Paul, right after this. We're back with Ron Paul. He's joining us from Clute, Texas, where he does his own show. It's a terrific show, by the way, on the internet. Ron, the House recently passed a bill that would open the Federal Reserve's activities, including deliberations on interest rates. We'd be able to see how they do it. Increased congressional scrutiny. Do you think that's going to pass, and do you favor it?
Obviously, I favor transparency. It was my bill. It was first passed a few years back, and it's been passed again in the House. But there was a time when Harry Reid was super supportive of auditing the Fed and knowing what they were doing. But now that he could do something about it, now he has backed off. But about 80% of the American people believe in transparency. They're not going to agree with me on what should be done with monetary policy, but the people say, yes, we ought to know. And this is a consequence of what happened on the bailout. They weren't dealing with about $1 billion that, or less than $1 trillion that the Congress was dealing with. They've dealt with $15 trillion to bail out other countries, other central banks, and other banks around the world. And the American people know about it, and this issue is not going to go away because our economy is very, very fragile, and the Federal Reserve has done nothing but one thing for the last 8 years, and that is print money at the fastest rate conceivable, and they really haven't produced a recovery. So this issue of the Federal Reserve and the need to know more about it is going to be with us for a long time.
President Obama said recently at Northwestern University that the past 6 years have been hard but steady and real, And as he said, it's indisputable that our economy is stronger today than it was 6 years ago. You agree?
Not really, because the bubble is bigger than ever. You can take the numbers. Government numbers are always questionable, but let's say that they are correct, that there are more people working today.
They are.
But there are more people in the workforce unemployed. 62% of the workforce is employed. That means more than 37% of the people are unemployed. And these new jobs that we just got recently, amazingly, it was people over 54. They were older people, and they were minimum wage jobs. And the people just getting out of college under, from 24 to 55, they lost 10,000 jobs. There's something really mixed up about it. So, no, there's no true economic growth. Right now, we're seeing a little bit of our money coming back because we've been in a trade, a negative balance and a trade deficit. We spend a lot of money in China. They have a lot of cash in the bank. Guess what? They're buying up Detroit right now. So, yes, there's something big going on in the economy, but I think we're very, very vulnerable for a continuation of the downturn. And though the government statistics say we're out of recession, for half of the population in the middle class is getting smaller, and the poor have gotten poorer, and the high middle income and rich are the ones who have benefited by the recovery.
Ron, recently you said that even though it ultimately failed at the ballot box, the campaign for Scottish independence should cheer supporters of secession movements springing up around the globe. Do you include, you would favor secession movements in the United States?
Well, they ought to all be legal. I mean, they were assumed to be legal when our Constitution was passed. Nobody would have joined the Union if there was a phrase in there to say, once you sign on, you can never leave the Union. There wouldn't have been one colony that would have signed in. And the secessionist sentiment has been around a long time. I mean, it's been up in Vermont even before the Civil War. But the important thing is not the secession as much as the right to secede. You know, if you can't leave somebody's house, you're a prisoner. If you can't leave a job, you're a slave. And if a smaller unit of government can't leave, and then you have a dictatorship. So the whole issue is if a state had the right to leave, the federal government would be a little bit, give a little bit more deference to the states. Right now, there's a fight to overcome the state or the federal government takeover, say, on the drug laws. The states are acting on their own. So I think the right of secession would have held in check the size and scope of the federal government.
So you'd have been opposed to Lincoln in 1860.
like Lysander Spooner and a few other very, very liberal-minded people that were strongly opposed to it. No, the right of secession should be there. All units of government, should be able to. I mean, what did we do in World War I? We went into World War I, and what we wanted was self-determination, and we wanted to take over, and yet we gave self-determination. Yeah, sure. We went into the Middle East. We took over the Middle East, and we drew those lines in the Middle East, and we're still fighting over those artificial boundaries, and that is not self-determination. I would say for the Middle East, self-determinations would mean that the Kurds have a right to Kurdistan. Allow them to have their homeland, and that's the way it should be around the world.
But you wouldn't have supported slavery.
Obviously not. But most Americans are enthusiastic about independence. What does independence from the British Empire mean? How can anybody be against it? And what about the breakup of the Soviet Union? That's fantastic. That was, to me, the greatest miracle of the 20th century. All of a sudden, this huge, huge, dictatorship empire just disintegrated because people exerted their right to leave. And I think, yes, secession and independence is a proper role. Let the people. This is a perfect solution for Ukraine. Why can't the Russian Ukrainians and the European Ukrainians just have an agreement? We'll be friends. We'll trade. We might even call ourselves Ukraine. But we want independent-minded people running our local government.
Why do people fear that?
And that, to me, would be a wonderful. Pardon me?
Why do people fear that? Why do people fear other people being free?
Well, I think they don't allow they don't allow it because of there are certain small minority of people who like to have the authority over others. They just delight. They're authoritarians. Yeah. Other times it's money. Oil and different things and finances. There's always some reason for it. But I think the people generally are for the smaller units of government and allowing groups to get together and be independent. But the stronger the government, the more resistance this is to the breaking up of a major union. There for a while, when the Soviet system was going, you tried to break off Czechoslovakia or Hungary, you were met with brute force. Yeah. But finally they weakened and it was no longer an issue.
Do you encourage your son to run for president?
Not really, and I have mixed feelings about it because I know what is entailed and how much punishment he gets. It always annoys me that he has to suffer some of the consequences because of something I said or did, and say, well, but he shouldn't have to do that, but that's the way the system works. So, yes, I think it's great that he's doing it. He has a good message, and he understands free market economics. And I just think that it's doing a world of good. But I also know the power and the strength of the establishment, and it's a tough road to hoe, I'll tell you that. But I would never have discouraged him from doing it, just like I didn't say, Rand, I really want to see you go to med school and be a doctor, but I never discouraged him and was delighted when he did go to medical school and become an ophthalmologist.
Would you campaign for him if asked?
If he chooses for me to go doing that, I campaign for him all the time because the message of liberty is his and the message of mine is liberty, and that's all I do all my life. For as long as I can remember, that's been my goal.
What do you make of this whole political situation now in America, this incredible rift between both sides, the Tea Party, the Republican Party, the Democratic Party? You can't get anything passed. People hate each other. What do you make of that?
Well, first, I think it's a sign of the economy. They're running out of money and running out of ideas, and we're a bankrupt country, and we have a foreign policy that's unmanageable. But I take a little different position on this because I think on the big things, they're too close together. I see if you take the Federal Reserve System, the leadership of both parties, boy, they come together. They're not going to have audit the Fed, and they're not going to talk about constitutional money. What about foreign policy? How about leaving the Congress here just a month ago? John Boehner and Reid got together and said, we're going to have an omnibus bill. We're going to put the money in here. We're going to give the president money for Syria. And they're both interventions. They're both for the war. So sometimes I would say there's too much bipartisanship. But I think the bickering is real. I think it's over power and special interests. And they're fighting over that. But I think it's because we're not rich like we were in the 1950s. They didn't have to worry about future. We were we had a positive trade balance, and we were the powerhouse of the world. But now, economically and militarily, believe it or not, I believe we're going to be threatened, and financially we're in bad shape. So I think that there's some restraint on the politicians in Washington, and that's what they're fighting over.
You expect any big changes in the midterm elections?
Philosophically, probably not. Partisan-wise, yes, there'll be some changes, but too often I was sort of rooting for Obama's more peaceful foreign policy, and he was going to be a better civil libertarian, but that didn't materialize. So I think that kind of thing can happen. Do you think, what would people think if Republicans have more control? They're going to all of a sudden have a balanced budget? people don't believe that. They're going to want to spend 10 times as much money on the military as Obama. Obama's getting beaten up because he doesn't spend enough. And here the constitutionalists and the libertarians say, hey, maybe he should do what he said. He just won the Nobel Peace Prize, for goodness sake. I would say that I'm cautious in my predictions of having the revolution. I'm waiting for the real revolution, the intellectual revolution, and it's coming.
Do you think Hillary will be formidable if she runs?
Oh, sure. Sure, the media will love her. But she'll get beat up, too.
What kind of president do you think she'd be?
president?
Well, yeah.
I would think she'd be pretty average, pretty mediocre, and pretty much for war, and pretty much for welfareism, and pretty much for deficits, pretty supportive of the Federal Reserve, and loving the military-industrial complex. But that's what we've been having, so I don't think she would provide any change whatsoever in a positive sense.
Why do you think your appeal is so great among the young?
Well, first they tell me, I ask the question all the time, and they say, well, we know you're telling them the truth. And that's nice to know. Young people have a more open mind. They're not locked in to a system. They don't have any special interests, and they haven't learned to deal with the government and become lobbyists and depend on the government. I think they like civil liberties. They like the message that I'm a very conservative person, but I don't want to tell other people how to live. And they understand that. And they also understand my message that I'm not divisive. I want to bring people together. You and I might not agree on how we want to use our liberties, but we can agree on what liberties should be. So liberals and conservatives and progressives should come together as long as we don't use force against somebody else. That is very appealing to young people, and the peace message, very powerful. With young people, and even though the wars continue, there was another statistic out that the young people, 70-some percent, don't want any part of this war, as well as our soldiers. They did a poll with our soldiers. They don't want to put troops over there either. So young people are especially open to these ideas.
Does that make you more optimistic than pessimistic about the future?
I'm more optimistic. I'm pretty much, yeah. But on the short run, I think the economy must go through the ringer. You have to liquidate debt, and you have to get rid of malinvestment. And since they won't allow that to happen for political reasons, it'll happen for just economic reasons, and we will go through that. But no, I think the young people encourage me a whole lot. They're studying free market, Austrian economics. They're understanding monetary policy. They like civil liberties, and they don't like war. And I still go to the campuses as much as I can, and the receptions are very good, and that makes me an optimist.
Ron, you're always a great guest. Always great seeing you. Thanks so much.
You're welcome, Larry. Nice to be with you.
Ron Paul, a great guest. We thank him so much for joining us, and thank you for joining me on Politicking.